Our second reading from Scripture for this morning comes to us from Mark's Gospel. As Catherine has already alluded to, it is one of Jesus' many parables, teachings to his followers. And so it is this morning that we listen to Mark, beginning reading in chapter 4, verses 26 through 34. Let us listen now for Jesus' words for us. Jesus also said, "The kingdom of God is as if someone would scatter seed on the ground and would sleep and rise night and day, and the seed would sprout and grow, he does not know how. The earth produces of itself first the stalk, then the head, then the full grain in the head. But when the grain is ripe, at once he goes in with his sickle because the harvest has come." Jesus also said, "With what can we compare the kingdom of God, or what parable will we use for it? It is like a mustard seed, which when sown upon the ground is the smallest of all the seeds on earth, yet when it is sown it grows up and becomes the greatest of all shrubs and puts forth large branches so that the birds of the air can make nests in its shade." With many such parables, Jesus spoke the word to them as they were able to hear it. He did not speak to them except in parables, but he explained everything in private to his disciples. Friends, here ends our scripture readings for us for this morning. May God add a blessing to our hearing and understanding of God's holy word. Well, the kingdom of God is like a mustard seed, a seed so tiny that it takes about 1,000 of them to fill up a thimble. Cast them into the field and they grow 5, maybe 6 feet tall, producing a canopy of brilliant yellow like fire on blazing sun. In a forest of mustard branches, birds and butterflies find their home. All is peace in the kingdom of heaven. Yes, Jesus, it is summertime, it's hot and humid, and we've begun thinking about vacations and time off, and it is hard to concentrate for long. And so it is fantastic that you tell us an easy, familiar parable for us to consider today. Yes, it's a good time. It's good from time to time to be confronted by obscure stories about our faith and tackle unpronounceable biblical names, but every now and then, it's really nice to get an easy story, one that we don't have to work so hard to know what it means. Jesus' story of the mustard seed is one of his most famous parables. And it, along with its cousin saying about faith, that if we have faith the size of a mustard seed, we can tell the mountain to remove to the sea, has even jumped from the Bible to popular culture. Yeah, Jesus, I think we got this one. This is what you're trying to tell us. Great things often have humble origins. Don't overlook something because of its size. Modest beginnings can have huge, powerful outcomes, and so forth. The parable seems to summarize the whole Christian enterprise. It is a preacher's dream. From small beginnings, you and I can change the world. From a handful of disciples to a global movement. Christendom has practically conquered the world. Roughly 1 out of every 3 humans is a Christian. This is the power of faith. Your faith may be weak, but strong faith can move mountains. It starts with little seed, but just watch and it will grow into the mightiest of shrubs. So preachers and hearers of this parable of the mustard seed have for centuries hyped dramatic growth through the power of faith. The parable has built impressive churches, conquered new lands and converted the heathen just from the promise inherent in one little seed. The parable plays well in America because it seems like the quintessential American story. The Pilgrims and the Mayflower, there's a mustard seed parable. A scraggly band of pilgrims fleeing religious persecution is transformed into the world's one remaining superpower with a gross domestic product that stymies the imagination. From the tiniest of seeds grows the greatest of trees. It's the story of First Presbyterian Church of Greensboro, that Romanesque cathedral on North Elm Street downtown that's full of stained glass windows and statues and looks all the world more like an Episcopal or a Catholic church than a Presbyterian one. And to think that First Presbyterian was an offshoot nearly 200 years ago of Buffalo Presbyterian, that modest brick building in Northeast Greensboro. We're talking mustard seed power. I suppose Starmount Presbyterian Church once fit the mold as well. From meager beginnings in 1952, a handful of folks from First Presbyterian and a handful of folks from Church of the Covenant crossed over Wendover into the wilds of undeveloped Greensboro and built a church on the outskirts of town, just as developers were making millions on old Starmount Forest. And they built this great facility. And at the height of its power and numbers, Starmount was the second largest Presbyterian church in town. Nipping at the heels of First Presbyterian, Starmount had mayors and city managers and representatives from the North Carolina House. From a tiny seed, smaller than the head of a pin, comes impressive growth and power to move mountains and conquer kingdoms, all for the glory of God. It's the parable of the mustard seed, where great things emerge from small beginnings. It's a great story, and it's easy to understand. Yet the reality is that nobody wants to be a little seed. Nobody wants to be small. Everybody wants to be taken seriously, to be afforded full human dignity, and to be recognized as somebody. Everybody wants to be given what is just. Nobody wants to be a little seed, to remain small, to be shamed or ridiculed or abused or overpowered or scorned or demonized. Nobody wants to be a little seed. That's the way it is with churches and institutions, and that's the way it is with peoples and individuals too. Countless sociological research has shown that shorter, smaller people, in general, are perceived as less attractive, less successful, and are paid significantly less than their bigger and taller peers. In the secret hidden places of our own personal story, we all want to be bigger, especially your 5'7", 150-pound pastor. And even when it comes to our faith, your prayer and mine is always, increase our faith, Lord, give us more. It's never, oh dear Lord, please shrink my faith. Give me less of it, please. So you and I, afraid of being little ourselves, often turn to belittling others. We run from our fear and build up bigger walls of exclusion and moralistic judgment. We run from our fear and divide people into good and evil. We run from our shame and squander our lives attempting to prove that we are the best and the brightest and the biggest, when inside, we all suspect that maybe we're not. It's because you and I are so small and we want to be big. We desperately want to be big, all of us, you and I, but we fear that we're small. Then if by chance we're given too much power, the power of the world, then we might just abuse that power and lord it over the weak and the poor and the alien and the different. With sufficient power, we lord it over the whole planet and destroy it with war and hate and injustice and intolerance because we so want to be big. We desperately want to be big because we fear that we are small. Nobody wants to be a little seed. And then Jesus gathers us, the whole crowd of us, small and large and in between. He gathers us here at church and he tells us a parable. The kingdom of heaven is like a mustard seed that someone took and sowed in his field. You see, there's a problem with our understanding of this parable. The problem is that you and I, we identify with the mustard seed. We want to increase and grow big just like the mustard plant. We hear the story of the mustard seed and we think, wow, what a great plant. They must have been really popular in the day. Maybe I ought to go out and buy me one. But here, you and I are letting our modern understanding color our understanding of the Bible. When you and I hear mustard seed, we think, great plant. And we get to make gray poupon with it as a bonus. But biblical scholars tell us, however, that the mustard seed that Jesus is referring to is not the sweet little plant that we get mustard for our summer hot dogs from. Jesus is talking about a mustard, kind of mustard that is in fact a noxious weed. Think kudzu or honeysuckle or wisteria. Nobody in their right mind sows weed seeds. They get in my garden and I rip them out. They're not popular plants. You won't find weeds available at the plant nursery or at the florist shop. Mustard plants are like ragweed. They are so destructive that they were banned from planted gardens. Even one of the Jewish sacred texts, the Mishnah, forbids sowing mustard seeds. Because they are useless, annoying weeds. Jesus said, the kingdom of heaven is like a mustard seed sown in the field. No one sows weed seeds, unless, of course, you're God. And so now you and I begin to understand more clearly. Mustard seeds are rejects, outcasts, riffraff, illegal aliens, differently abled persons, the lower class, despised and excluded. But by God, they do grow. By God, they are part of the kingdom of heaven. They grow like weeds, strong, dignified, and at peace, and birds of the air make their nests in them. What an odd story. Jesus envisions God's intention as sowing weed seeds. He would have all who follow him to reach out not to the winners, not to the kingdom builders, not to the people in positions of power and influence, but to the losers, to the Latino kid flunking math and English. To the woman going through a divorce, to the man struggling with his anger, to the single parent striving to make ends meet and raise decent kids in a hostile world, to the failed professional taking the first steps towards recovery after hitting bottom, to the immigrant in our midst, illegal or otherwise. Jesus would have us reach out to these and all like them. Because Jesus reaches out to us in our brokenness, in our lostness, in our spiritual poverty, in our injury, and yes, in our sin. Jesus says, the kingdom of heaven is like you and me, weed seeds. But far too often the church who bears the name of Jesus Christ, rejects him and his intention for the world. We reject him, each and every one of us, without fail. We nail him to the cross because we are scared. We kill Jesus because we're frightened. then in the full power of the love of God, Jesus forgives us. In a dazzling display of amazing grace and resurrection power, Jesus forgives us and says, come on in, this is your home. Home to a stable, home to a cross on a lonely hill, home to an empty tomb, home to a room where in a rush of mighty wind, divine power is poured out and enters into our lives and casts us into the field of faith. Mustard seeds, each and every one of us. The proud and the shamed. The puffed up and the humble. The broken and the healing. The weak and the strong. You and I are mustard seeds, weed seeds, growing into the full dignity of God in the church, where the poor are rich, where the color of one's skin makes no difference, where all of God's children, every one of them, gathers and knows that he or she is infinitely loved, infinitely cared for, infinitely a child of God, and where the birds of the air and you and I find a home, where no one is a stranger, no one is an outcast, where there is a place and a plan and a purpose and a meaning, even for the most noxious weed. That, brothers and sisters, is what the kingdom of heaven is like. Mustard seed power. Where from small beginnings, you and I and the world are transformed into a glorious display of the love of God. The love of God who redeems even the weeds and makes them useful and makes them and us the heroes of his story. This is the faith in which we stand. This is the faith in which we find our salvation. And this, my fellow mustard seeds, is the faith that we are called to live and to share. Thanks be to God.